outdoor trawl operating, it would also provide extra work to fish plants in four coastal communities. Cartwright, Mary's Harbor, Lancelot, and Fortow. Frank Flynn of Fortow is the president of the Labrador Fishermen's Union Shrimp Company. He says they're very disappointed that they didn't get the quota they were looking for.
They should make some kind of arrangement to give us at least 1,500 tons of that morning cod. And Labrador was completely left out. We are people adjacent to the stock. We have the capability of catching it, and I think that we deserve some.
Flynn said they requested a meeting last week with Federal Fisheries Minister Tom Sidden, but so far they haven't received a reply. He said they plan to meet next week with Provincial Fisheries Minister Tom Rideout to see if they can get provincial support. Mike Downey, CBC News, Happy Valley, Goose Bay.
Newfoundland's unemployment rate jumped a percentage point last month to 18%. There were 42,000 Newfoundlanders unemployed in December, an increase of around 3,000 over the previous month. A spokesman for Statistics Canada says the unemployment rate in Newfoundland usually goes up late in the year. That's because of a slowdown in such industries as the fishery and construction. However, more Newfoundlanders had jobs in December than the same month a year earlier.
The province's decision to move to double daylight savings time this spring is holding up bookings for the summer crossing of the Argentia ferry service. Passengers are unable to make reservations on the ferry until Marine Atlantic sorts out a new schedule. Pamela Tennant reports.
You always have to book well in advance if you want to travel the Ambrosche from Argentia to North Sydney. So this morning, Ross Daw decided to call and make sure there would be room for his family aboard the ship in June when they took their summer vacation. He couldn't believe what he heard.
They said, no, I'm sorry, we can't take any reservations anymore from Argentia until you Newfoundlanders get a straight on your what you're doing with your time changes.
Marine Atlantic has put a hold on taking reservations after the end of March. They say the province's decision to move ahead 2 hours instead of 1 hour this spring forced them to change their schedule.
Well, the new time change that was announced by the government did cause us some problem with our time schedule. We've had to put reservations on hold for a short period of time. We have to enter a new schedule into our reservation computer system.
Marine Atlantic hopes to have its new schedule straightened out by next week and to once again begin taking reservations for the ferry. Ross Daw says he'll be back on the phone Monday morning. He says he doesn't care what time the ferry runs. All he wants is a reservation. Pamela Tennant, CBC News, St. John's.
St. John's firefighters want a meeting with Justice Minister Lynn Burge to discuss a dispute they're having with the fire chief. Fire Chief Silas Stanley has accused the firefighters of abusing sick leave. The abuse, he said, has resulted in high overtime costs, driving up the cost of operating the fire department. The Firefighters Association admits there's likely some abuse of sick leave, but feels it's nowhere near the level suggested by the fire chief. Association President Kevin Pittman says figures being circulated by the fire chief are inaccurate and misleading. Pittman says they'll wait until their meeting with the justice minister before deciding whether to vote on a non-confidence motion against their chief.
And coming up in the national and international news, unemployment is up in Newfoundland, but nationally it's at its lowest level in more than 6 years.
In national and international news tonight, Statistics Canada says that the seasonally adjusted unemployment rate dropped to 8.1% last month, down from 8.2% in November. That's the lowest national unemployment figure for more than 6 years. Anna Maria Tremonti reports.
The number of job seekers has thinned at this manpower office in Toronto, while cards describing the jobs available crowd the bulletin boards. It's something new in a city that now has one of the lowest unemployment rates in the country.
Not as many clients coming in, and we've certainly seen an increase in the number of job orders, employers seeking clients, so we're sort of running into a bit of a problem balancing that.
There are still 1 million people looking for work in Canada, but the unemployment rate fell to 8.1% in December, its lowest level in 6 years. The jobless rate remains higher in the Atlantic provinces than in any other region of the country. Newfoundland is still the province with the highest unemployment rate. In Quebec, the number of people looking for work rose slightly. Ontario's jobless rate is low but uneven, from a high of 13% in Sudbury to a low of 3% in Kitchener-Waterloo. In the West, Manitoba's jobless rate has dropped slightly. There have been only marginal increases in the other three western provinces. Overall, there's been a steady increase in jobs over the past year, and most of them have been full-time jobs. But it is still more difficult for younger Canadians between the ages of 15 and 24 to find work. Anna Maria Tremonti, CBC News, Ottawa.
It has been another disastrous day on the stock markets. In Toronto, the TSE Composite Index fell by almost 120 points, while in New York, the Dow Jones Industrial Average dropped by more than 140 points. It was the third biggest one-day decline ever for the Dow Industrials. The legislature in British Columbia has now passed into law amendments that will allow for the quarantine of some AIDS victims. The law allows the province to restrict the activity of AIDS carriers who willfully, carelessly, or because of mental incompetence spread the disease. AIDS support groups and human rights activists tried to fight the legislation.
The police chief in Edmonton has ordered a second internal investigation into the conduct of officers accused of brutality during a domestic incident last summer. During the incident, the fingers of two men were twisted and broken after they had been handcuffed. No charges were laid after a first internal investigation. But last month, the provincial court judge said the police used brutal and unnecessary force, and then tailored the evidence to cover up their actions.
Israeli troops have now killed 25 Palestinians in the occupied territories during a month of protests. Yesterday, a 15-year-old demonstrator became the latest to die. Today, scattered violence continued in the occupied Arab lands. Martin Fletcher of NBC News reports.
These are pictures the Palestinians want the world to see. Israeli soldiers and police fighting Palestinians who are armed only with stones. It's an image Israel hates. The rioting has become a form of propaganda war the government has trouble dealing with.
It is an additional phase or an additional form of warfare against the existence and independence of the state of Israel.
Another new element in Palestinian resistance began today, a call for civil disobedience made by Hannah Signora, a newspaper editor.
What we are calling for is an end of the occupation.
First, a ban on Israeli cigarettes, then on Israeli soft drinks, then a refusal by occupied Arabs to pay Israeli taxes, and finally, they'll stop working in Israel. Although many Arabs dismiss the plan as unrealistic, for Signora, it's part of the propaganda war.
We have to keep the spotlight on the issues that the situation is this one.
While the army is sure it'll soon end the rioting, the government's more concerned about its image in the world. Marlon Fletcher, NBC News, Jerusalem.
No Canadians were injured when a violent thunderstorm swept over the 16th World Boy Scout Jamboree near Sydney, Australia. Three English scouts and one from Australia were treated for minor injuries after tents were blown down by the storm. About 800 Canadian scouts were among the 16,000 from 71 countries attending the Jamboree.
The past 24 hours have been especially hard on Montreal firefighters. They've had to battle two spectacular fires in freezing cold temperatures. About 100 men attacked a major blaze this morning, while last night they tackled a huge natural gas fire near the Olympic Stadium. Steve Hauser has the story.
Just after 6 o'clock last night, flames suddenly started shooting out of a hole in the ground. They leapt to the night sky, licking and burning the tops of trees. Work crews had been trying to fix a small leak in a natural gas line.
Fire started suddenly without any logical explanation. We don't have any logical explanation right now to give.
An explosion. That's it. An explosion. I told my wife, come on, let's get out of here fast. So we just got out. Didn't want to stay there.
Miraculously, there was only one small injury to a gas company employee.
They'll burn. Nothing wrong with this person.
As flames turned the street into a bubbling cauldron, firemen tried to save nearby buildings.
No, it's next door. I don't know yet.
Anxious residents waited word on their apartments. Today, icicles, water, and smoke damage are keeping at least 20 people from their homes. In the second fire, which investigators believe may have been deliberately set, another 8 families are homeless and several businesses have been destroyed, but no one was injured. Steve Hauser, CBC News, Montreal.
2 people are under arrest following an investigation into the illegal killing of 3 elk on Highway 40, southwest of Calgary. The poachers killed and gutted the animals, but took only the hind quarters. They were part of a herd that ranges through the area. The highway is usually closed to protect the elk, but has been left open this winter to provide extra access to skiing events at the Olympic Games. Environmentalists are seeking a court injunction to have the highway closed.
And that's the national and the international news. When we come back, we'll have a panel discussion about this week's cabinet shuffle, the promotions, demotions, and what it all means.
There were enough changes made in Wednesday's cabinet shuffle to keep political commentators busy for a while. Certainly more than enough for our panel this evening.
And with me in the studio to talk about the cabinet shuffle, I have John Calver, who is CBC Radio's national reporter in Newfoundland and Labrador, and Bill Callahan, the managing editor of the St. John's Evening Telegram. Let's talk about how everybody is still in the cabinet, plus a couple. Why were there no firings out of this cabinet?
I don't know. That's probably a good question. Why were there no firings? There were a couple of cabinet ministers there that could have been, under different circumstances, I think, fired. But when you look around at the Conservative caucus right now and who's there and who's not there, unless you're talking about a whole major realignment of the government process in Newfoundland, and that's cutting out departments and jamming them together or something, what else are you going to do? Who are you going to put in the cabinet but those people that are now in it?
Do you see it that way, Bill?
Well, there are a number of things you could say about it, I suppose, about this whole affair. The first one is, and I watched the premier, and then I went over to see Alice in Wonderland, and I came away being a little confused. I'm having problems separating them. But
isn't that it?
Well, I'll leave that for discussion next week, maybe. But no, I think that very definitely the bottom line on this is life insurance. I think that if the people
Hector's life.
And the governments. I think if the people who might have been and perhaps should have been disciplined or turfed out had been, you would have seen either a departure to the other side of the House, or you would have seen some resignations and by-elections, and I think that neither of these was tenable. If, you know, if the present buoyant approach of the premier is to be maintained. So I really think that he couldn't afford. Mm-hmm. And I hear things, as I'm sure we all do, about who may be, you know, threatening to go across the floor or that kind of mm-hmm. thing. I'm told there were 3, actually, who were making threats. And you remember some
who
time
are
ago.
They?
Well, we some time ago talked here about Mr. Power, for example, mm-hmm. and why his resignation wasn't being demanded when it was being asked for and refused, why he wasn't being just
that,
flicked out.
That possibility mm-hmm. has been touted around.
We discussed that, and I think there are others who perhaps have been of like mind.
Well, I think that's the whole process that Mr. Peckford has just gone through, taking a government that's been around for a long, long time, trying as best he can to put a new face on it, and if it works, it works. If it doesn't, what else could I do, sort of thing.
Okay,
in the meantime, advise him some time, and I think in politics that's always mm-hmm. the principal consideration.
Then I want to ask you, as a person who was once a cabinet minister, how important it is to a cabinet minister that you're demoted or promoted? Do those things mean something in there, and do those different portfolios have that kind of importance to those people?
I think they do indeed, and there's a fair bit of competition, especially among the younger people who, you know, who are ambitious and want to get ahead and
so
perhaps someday
people,
stand for the leadership.
Were there then people who were definitely demoted?
Oh, I think there's obviously 3 or 4
absolutely.
Demotions here. I think that's fairly clear.
The ones that we've discussed, again, like Mr. Power and Mr. Daw, for example, they'd be the
Charlie
primary
Brett.
Ones, and Charlie mm-hmm. Brett, who've been causing the government embarrassment and so on. You know, I think flicking them out in all the circumstances, would have been the last resort.
Mm-hmm.
So you try to live with them, and you try to keep everything settled down, but you make it plain that you're not going to be a pet.
What do you think of Mr. Peck for taking that energy portfolio? He says he wants to send a signal. Does that send a signal that means anything to anybody?
He says he wants to send a signal, but I have another idea that's been kicking around in the back of my head for some time, and that's Brian Peckford's I Have a Dream. That goes back many, many, many years ago. And one of those, one of the things in that trilogy of dreams was the offshore.
Right.
And I think if Brian Peckford can get something going on the offshore in a development sense, whether it's White Rose or Terra Nova, most unlikely Hibernia, but if he can get something going, having reorganized his old tired government and put a new face on it, reorganized the bureaucracy that goes with it, I think he can then sit back and say, okay, I've given you this reorganized government, party faithful. I've delivered at least one of my trilogy of promises, and this is it, now I'm
gone.
And
now I'm going to an election.
Either going to an election or I'm gone. I know he told you that he was going to stay for the next election, but if this comes true, if he can get that offshore oil development going in some sense, in some way, I still wouldn't be surprised to see him go.
Well, he's had an election on less than a development, though. He's had
Indeed.
Elections on promises of development.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed. I think that what this does, again, is keep his options open. I mean, it no matter what happens, it's a good thing to do. It either ensures his place in history, so to speak, or it gives him or the party, you know, a good position going into an election.
What do you make of him coming out of the closet, though? I mean, he was not available, wouldn't talk to people.
It's all part of the mix. It's all part of the new face. If there's a new face, there has to be a new sort of level of energy to go along with it, and a new sort of openness. Brian Peckford's own perestroika.
I think, too, there's been some serious talking in the party in the last few weeks. So I hear that the principal money raisers have been in, and others have been in, and they've pretty well laid the law down and said, now, Brian, you know, we've been good to you. We don't want any of this nonsense of you walking away and leaving us high and dry. We want the party in good shape when you go. Now, we're not telling you to go, but if you don't do what has to be done, then we'll tell you to go. So I think it's been a rough time. I think that all due respect to Mr. Peckford, you know, the idea that, you know, nobody wants him to go and everybody wants him to stay, I think we have to take with a very large lump of salt. I think he's been had a good talking to, and the result of it is that he's going to do what has to be done. And whether it's for an election, we'll see, the polls will tell him that, or whether it's to prepare for somebody else's election, In any event, the party stands to benefit, and I think that's
one last
that's
comment, John. We're running out.
And somewhere in all this lies the real story of what's going to happen over the next year or two.
Thanks very much, both of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The Newfoundland courts today ruled that a Spanish trawler arrested last week will be allowed to return to Spain. But the owner will have to post a bond of $1.4 million. That's a record bail. But the court says the trawler had to be brought into St. John's by force, and the charges against it are serious. Marilyn Boone reports.
The Rio de Pontevedra is the first foreign trawler to be arrested by armed fisheries officers. Its captain and owner have been in court three times this week trying to get the vessel released. Today they succeeded, but the court set a record bail of $1.4 million. It looks like the owner of the trawler, Antonio Sotelo, will be able to post a bond through chartered banks. But an interpreter explained that Sotelo thinks it's a pretty steep price to pay.
The only thing he said that is there's a very, very heavy burden on him, extremely heavy.
The court has also slapped a stiff bail on the trawler's fishing master. Jose Arias will be kept in police custody until he posts bail of $175,000.
This man was never in trouble for any criminal or any illegal action. He sees himself in the penitentiary now, and he's very confused. Yes, he is.
In the meantime, the captain of the vessel, Jaime Rivas, has elected trial by a Supreme Court judge. He'll be pleading not guilty to charges of illegal fishing and obstructing fisheries officers. Under Canada's tough new fisheries regulations, he could be fined $1.75 million. That's something the court considered in setting the terms for releasing the vessel. In setting bail today, Judge John Trahey had little sympathy for the owner of the Spanish trawler. A few months ago, Antonio Sotelo bought another vessel worth about $750,000. Judge Trahey says the fishery must be a lucrative business for the Spaniard. In the meantime, while this vessel is expected to leave St. John's next week, she'll have to come back here for sentencing. A preliminary hearing on the matter will be held in June. Marilyn Boone, CBC News, St. John's.
A man from the Buren Peninsula community of Pointe aux Galles has died in an accident involving an all-terrain vehicle. 23-year-old Maurice James Lockyer was badly injured when he was found lying near his machine at the edge of a pond on Monday night. The man died in hospital in St. John's on Wednesday. An RCMP spokesman says it appears Lockyer was thrown from the ATV after he lost control of the machine. And we'll be back with more right after these messages.
Here it now continues from the West Coast with Daryl Maloney.
Good evening, everyone. People on the Port-au-Port Peninsula are afraid it could become an island if waves wash away the narrow strip of land in the area. Heavy seas in the storm the past few days washed away part of the breakwater, protecting the isthmus to the peninsula. People are saying the damage to the breakwater could lead to two big problems for them if something isn't done quickly. Doug Greer took a look at the situation today and has this report.
The wind and waves have died down now, but when they pounded away the section of breakwater Tuesday and Wednesday, they stopped just short of taking the main power line to the Port-au-Port Peninsula. The natural breakwater and another narrow neck that carries the road are all that separate Bay St. George and Port-au-Port Bay, and they're all that join the Port-au-Port Peninsula to the island of Newfoundland. Without the two threads of land, Port-au-Port would be an island itself.
It could be very serious.
Danny McCann is the town clerk in Port-au-Port West. Now the breakwater has been weakened, he says another storm could take the rest of it, exposing the road strip to the waves. And peninsula residents would lose access to important services.
We'd lose our hospital. There's no drug stores. Many services we just don't have on the peninsula. We would lose all that.
A lightened power crew is working to shore up the power line, though that won't do much good if another storm takes the rest of the breakwater. The prevailing winds bring the waves straight in here. McCann says the only way to keep Port-au-Port from becoming a separate island is to repair the breakwater before it's too late. Doug Greer, CBC News, on the Port-au-Port Peninsula.
Cornerbrook Mayor Ray Pollitt says last year was one of the best ever for the city, but not as good as 1988 is shaping up to be. Pollitt told the city's Chamber of Commerce today that to make sure Cornerbrook keeps getting stronger, some aggressive action is needed. Terry LeDrew has this report.
I have to say it was a banner year.
Business people in Cornerbrook got an earful of good news today. Good news about last year. It was the best construction year the city's seen, with nearly $23 million worth of building going on. A new fine arts college, new police headquarters, a new church, and a new bank, to name a few. A new hotel, fast food restaurant, and apartment building are planned. Marble Mountain's development into a full-fledged ski resort has gotten government's nod. And good news for this year, Atlantic Seaworks Limited and Atlantic Container Express are going to start using the harbor.
They will definitely be coming back again in March 1988, sailing out of Montreal. And there are, believe it or not, one or two more looking at us. And we too are looking at a service from here to Goose Bay and a service from St. John, New Brunswick. So truly we can see that our port is coming back into its own.
Pollitt says this is the start of Cornerbrook's recognition as a main distribution center, and the entire West Coast will profit. To make sure even more businesses are attracted here, Pollitt will meet with government representatives to dust off the harbor development scheme.
Oh, there's no question. I think when Mr. Crosby was down one time before, if you recall, he said, well, what comes first, the chicken or the egg? And, well, now the two shipping companies under the deregulation are here. So, therefore, I'm sure that the Department of Transportation will assist us in the work that needs to be done.
He says he's confident work on the harbor will start this year. Terry LeDrew, CBC News, Cornerbrook.
The Cornerbrook Chamber of Commerce thinks government's plan to try out a new daylight saving scheme is a bad idea. The province will try out new extra hour of daylight savings time this spring to save on energy, cut down on road accidents, and to increase one's enjoyment of the spring and summer. But the city's Chamber of Commerce says it doesn't go along with the plan, and neither do a lot of other people in this area. Chamber President Shirley Frost.
Businesses are concerned about the effect it's going to have on how they operate. Banks, for example, have major concerns because all their data processing is done outside of this province in Halifax. Most businesses have to deal with Toronto, Montreal, and places west, which makes it very difficult. It's difficult now, but it's going to be twice as difficult. And the general public just appear to be concerned with the effect it's going to have on their lifestyle.
Frost says the chamber will write the provincial government to express their concerns and ask for meetings. Even if that doesn't prevent the new daylight savings program from going ahead experimentally, Frost says it might persuade government to think again about making a permanent change. Let's check our local sports for this Friday evening. Joseph, go to it, sir.
Okay, let's look at what's happening around the area this weekend. Newfoundland senior hockey in this end of the province. Cornerbrook Royals at home to the Mount Pearl Blades Saturday night and Sunday afternoon. Stephenville Jets home and home to Port Basque Mariners, also Saturday, Sunday. The first game Saturday night is in Stephenville. And the first test for Cal Dunville as playing coach of the Stephenville Jets will be this weekend. St. John's are at home to Gander. Senior hockey team reps will be in Cornerbrook this weekend. I had thought the meeting was Sunday, but apparently it's been moved now to Saturday here in Cornerbrook. They'll talk about the league to date. And the Royals apparently are discussing things with Rob Forbes over in Europe. Cliff Gorman says, well, he's talked to Rob, but nothing is definite on his returning as yet. Darren Coburn continues to score points for the Cornwall Royals in the OHL. Last night he had two goals in a 4-4 tie with the Sudbury team in Cornwall. He now has 25 goals and 26 assists. That was the game they should have won. They were ahead 4-3 with just about 25 seconds or so remaining. Lost the puck and gave up the tying goal. Air Canada Cup Midget Hockey in Deer Lake last night. Deer Lake beat Cornerbrook 6-5. They did it in an unusual way. The Deer Lake team scored two shorthanded goals in the last 5 minutes of play. A Deer Lake player was sitting out a two-minute minor and a five-minute fighting major when Francis Hoff and Michael Jane scored for Deer Lake. Sean Reeder, Sean Tobin, two each for Cornerbrook. The Deer Lake record is now 1-1-1, while Cornerbrook is 2-2-1. In Cornerbrook Labatt's basketball last night, the senior league, Regina High School Knights beat the Career Academy. Bit of an upset there, 81-77. Greg Reed, 26 points for Regina. Rob Kelly at 10. Rob Evans, 24. Jim Hughes, 23 for the losing team. Westside Monarchs, 81-65 over Pepsi. Joe Randall, 24. Byrne Joyce, 19 for the Monarchs. Bob Reed, 17 for Pepsi. Ed Joyce had 13. The league continues Monday night at Regina. Pasadena Cross Country Ski Club hold final registration for Jackrabbits and adults from 12:45-1:15 at the Pasadena Rec Center on Sunday. Jackrabbits should prepare for on-snow instruction following registration and cross-country instruction for beginners from 1:30 to 3 o'clock at the Blow Me Down Cross Country Ski Club this weekend as well. That's on Saturday. And I might say here, Cliff Gorman spent 65 hours on the ferry Northern Ranger trying to get across in that storm.
But he got his smokes.
He got there.
All right. Here now continues with After This.
Carl Wells, and now with the latest weather information. And Carl, what kind of weekend we got on the way? I hear there's some snow on the way.
Have we got much? Yes, we do have some snow on the way. 10 to 15 centimeters for the island. Labrador's not going to get any snow tomorrow, though. And it's going to change to rain for the Avalon Peninsula. Avalon and Buren Peninsula. Across Canada today, pretty good day actually. A fair amount of sunshine throughout Canada. Temperatures standing pretty well where they've been over the past couple of days. Still nice and warm out on the Pacific coast in Vancouver, too, with overcast skies there. Minus 21 and sunny in Edmonton. Minus 22 with ice crystals in Regina today, actually, and in Winnipeg, minus 24 and sunny skies there. Minus 6 degrees and cloudy in Toronto, minus 17 with snow for Montreal, minus 10 and sunny skies in Halifax, a fair amount of sunshine in the Atlantic provinces today, minus 7 and sunny for St. John's, a beautiful day. In Labrador, there was some cloud in the west, otherwise a nice sunny day throughout Labrador as well. Minus 21 degrees at Nain, minus 22 in Wabush, minus 24 in Churchill Falls, minus 22 in Goose Bay, minus 17 degrees in Cartwright. On the island today, with the exception of the Port of Basque area, which had some flurries, beautiful, bright, sunny day today.
For this Friday, it was minus 16 degrees in St. Anthony, minus 10 in Cornerbrook, minus 7 in Port Basque, minus 10 in Gander, minus 5 in St. Lawrence, minus 6 in Bonavista, minus 7 in St. John's. Well, there's not going to be too much happening overnight. For the province, thanks to the ridge of high pressure, which gave the nice sunny weather to pretty well all of us today. Tomorrow, however, there is a system making its way in from the American seaboard. This one right here, and this has caused the Nova Scotia Weather Office to put out a heavy snowfall warning for Nova Scotia. It looks like they're going to get clobbered with over 20 centimeters of snow from that system. It's going to be affecting mainly the island tomorrow, giving snow, it looks like, about 10 to 15 centimeters accumulation, but for the Avalon Peninsula, the Buren Peninsula as well, that snow will be changing to rain tomorrow evening, so it looks like less snow for that area. Here's what it looks like for tonight, though. Not much happening, basically good weather for Labrador, some cloud in the north and west, and a few clouds through the remainder, light winds, and clear for the island with light winds. For tomorrow, bit of a different story, cloudy for Labrador with some snow flurries in the west. But all in all, a pretty good day, light winds. And for the island, winds picking up strong easterlies, and that'll cause some blowing snow once the snow starts. And the snow will start by tomorrow around lunchtime. And as I indicated, it will change to rain in the southeast later on tomorrow evening. Now, here's your local forecast. For Wabush, Labrador City, Maine to Hopedale, Churchill Falls, tonight cloudy with flurries, minus 23. Tomorrow, cloudy with light snow, minus 15 to minus 23. For Goose Bay, Postville to Cartwright, Bateau to Lance Eau Claire, tonight a few clouds, minus 20 to minus 25. Tomorrow, becoming cloudy with flurries in the evening, minus 10 to minus 15. And on the island, for the West Coast, Northern Bayburt Peninsula, tonight cloudy periods, minus 10 to minus 13, except minus 20 over the Northern Peninsula. Tomorrow, cloudy with snow on the west coast by noon, making its way to the Northern Peninsula by evening, and minus 3 to minus 6 degrees. For central Newfoundland, the east and south coast except the Buren Peninsula, tonight a few clouds, minus 10 to minus 13, except minus 18 inland. Tomorrow, snow 0 to minus 3, and for St. John's, the Avalon Buren Peninsula, tonight a few clouds, minus 7 to minus 10. Tomorrow, cloudy with afternoon snow, changing to rain in the evening, 1 degree. In the extended Sunday, flurries for everybody. Monday and Tuesday, sunny for Labrador and cloudy for the island on those days. And that's the weather report. Have a good weekend. Here's Ann.
It's time for sports now with Jonathan Crowe. What's on your agenda this evening?
We've got lots of stuff. We've got Gino Cicerelli being suspended, and but first we're going to get to the good news, the nice stuff, the stuff that everybody wants to hear. Then we'll get to the bad news.
Okay. Good stuff first.
Yeah. It won't be long before athletes from all over the world descend on Calgary for the 1988 Winter Olympics. Meanwhile, many of the world's top disabled athletes are gearing up for next week's Paralympics in Innsbruck, Austria. One of Canada's athletes at the Games will be Dr. Francine Lemaire, a cross-country skier from Cornerbrook, and Joe Mullins has this report.
Dr. Francine Lemaire had her left leg amputated at an early age after a tumor around the lower part of the thigh from age 3 caused growth problems leading to the amputation.
When I was 11, there was an 8 inches difference between the two legs, and it was felt that probably the amputation of the disabled leg was a better alternative for me in the long run.
So that was at age 11?
At age 11, yeah. I'm 35 today, so it's quite some time ago now, but I would have to say that this was probably the right decision because it has opened my life to lots of activities which I was not able to do before.
Dr. Lemaire has only been skiing for 7 years, 4 competitively, but hard work and determination has made her a member of our national team at the Paralympics. In fact, this is her third time in world competition.
My first competition was in 1984. This was for a Paralympic game like this one. I came fourth in those events. And there was another world competition in 1986, and I did win the 10-kilometer race in that event.
In previous years, she's been the only above-the-knee amputee at the Games. Why there aren't more is hard to explain.
It's interesting, and I don't really know why that is for sure. It's a big category in the men, above-knee amputee cross-country skiing, but in the past, I've always been the only female above-knee amputee cross-country skiing. I do know that this year, for sure, there will be at least one other above-knee amputee competing from the States.
Francine Lemaire works hard to be number one. On this day, we couldn't follow to the cross-country speech trail because of storm conditions, but she's off for a workout, hoping for a strong showing in Austria. Joe Mullins, CBC Sports, Corner Brook.
Well, the Mount Pearl Blades are playing themselves right out of playoff contention. They were at the stadium last night to play the Capitals. St. John's moving into first place with an embarrassingly easy 18-2 win.
It doesn't take long for the Capitals to get going in this one. They get their first just 27 seconds in. Eddie Oates beating Peter White to make it 1-0 St. John. The Capitals get another at the midway point of the period. A great individual effort by Bill McDougal here. He goes all the way in and gives St. John's a 2-0 lead. McDougal gets a second of the night. Just a few seconds later, he finds the corner on White, and it's 3-0 McDougal with three goals on the night. The game quickly slipping away from the Blades as St. John's leads 5-0 after the first 20 minutes. The Blades show signs of life early in the second period as Richard Linto feeds Chris Tomlin. A nice pass, Tomlin makes it 5-1, but that's just about the last sign of life. Mount Pearl shows the Blades are dead on arrival as they go on to lose 18-2. Pretty dull hockey on the whole, but Bill Riley does liven things up in the third period as he dances a jig to the penalty box.
No, that's not Brian Orser in disguise. Capitals goaltender Roger Kennedy was back in goal for the team last night. Kennedy has been sitting out a two-game suspension following the big brawl during December 13th's game with the Portobasque Mariners. Kennedy, who was also a policeman, was disciplined by Constabulary Chief Ed Cody following an incident after that game in which he insulted members of the media. Chief Cody won't say what penalty was handed out to Kennedy, and he says that he considers the case to be closed. Well, Toronto City Police will charge Minnesota North Stars forward Dino Ciccarelli with assault the next time he's in Toronto. That word comes 2 days after Ciccarelli attacked the Leafs' Luke Richardson with his stick during a game at Maple Leaf Gardens. Meanwhile, NHL Vice President Brian O'Neill has reacted to the incident, handing out a suspension.
Ciccarelli gets a 10-game suspension for this incident on Wednesday night when he responded to a cross-check from Luke Richardson by hammering the Toronto Maple Leaf around the head with a stick. Ciccarelli showed no remorse after the incident, saying he was provoked and would do it all over again if he had to. Meanwhile, the Minnesota North Stars will have to do without their leading scorer for 10 games.
By the way, the North Stars will be back in Toronto February 24th. They're not saying whether Ciccarelli will be coming with them. Canada's Olympic hockey team was in Hamilton for last night's eighth and final game of their series with the Soviet Selects. Canada was looking to tie the series at four games apiece. Instead, they came out flat and allowed the Soviets to win the game and the series.
The Soviets get on the board 8 minutes into the game. Andrei Chestiakov with the shot. That's deflected past Andy Moat by Oleg Starkov, and that makes it 1-0 Soviets. The Soviets get another goal, this time on a 2-on-1. Anatoly Stepanishev beats Sean Burke. The Soviets go on to win this one 3-1 and wrap up the 8-game series 5-3 in Hamilton. To the NHL now and the Philadelphia Spectrum, where St. Louis trails 3-2 until this play. Jim Benning takes the shot. Mark Hunter pokes it by Ron Hextall. That ties the game at 3. Now the Flyers reply with 3 straight goals, though. Brian Propp to Mark Howe to Rick Tocchet. Philadelphia wins 6-4 and moves into first place in the Patrick Division. Pittsburgh now, where the Boston Bruins are the visitors. It's 1-0 Boston. Steve Kasper carries it in. Randy Burge tips in his pass, and it's 2-0 Bruins. Boston will get more. The Penguins can't clear the zone on this play. Cam Neely picks up the loose puck, feeds Jeff Cortnell, who fires it in. The Bruins go on to win this one 3-2. Terry O'Reilly and his team moving into a first-place tie with Montreal in the Adams Division.
Canada's second-ranked male high jumper was killed yesterday in a multi-car pileup outside Toronto. 23-year-old Chris Scott died as a result of an accident which occurred during a snowstorm in the Toronto area. Scott had placed second to Milt Oddie in last year's national championships. Well, there's a full schedule of games on the senior hockey schedule this weekend. The St. John's Capitals host the poor and boring Gander Internationals for 2 games. The Mount Pearl Blades are in Corner Brook for 2, and the Mariners and Jets kick off a 2-game home-and-home series tomorrow night in Stephenville. There's some good curling action to be seen this weekend at the Ballyhaley Curling Club in St. John's. The Eastern Zone Tournament of the Women's Scott Tournament of Hearts competition got underway about 20 minutes ago. The event features 5 teams and will continue through Sunday. And Toronto welterweight Sean O'Sullivan is the favorite going into tonight's 12-round fight with Luis Santana. The fight takes place in Las Vegas, and the stakes are the vacant North American Boxing Federation's welterweight crown. And that's sports. Hope you have a great weekend. Here's Ann.
And here are the news highlights. Premier Peckford and his new and shuffled cabinet ministers were sworn in today. The cabinet now has 23 members, including three new faces. A 36-year-old Roman Catholic priest, Father Laurie Locke, has been charged with dangerous use of a firearm. Locke allegedly fired two rifle shots through the window of the Miracle Temple in Lewisport on Monday night. And Newfoundland's unemployment rate rose to 18% last month. That was an increase of 1 percentage point over November. Those are the highlights. Here's Glenn.
Thank you, Ann. That's Here and Now for Friday, January the 8th. As we roll the names of the people who worked on Here and Now this week, we'll show you some pictures of a group of children enjoying themselves this afternoon at Pippi Park in St. John's. Thank you for being with us. Have a good weekend. Good night.
Of CBC's popular series Red Surge. Stay tuned now for the best years, followed by Golden Girls.